This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, NIL Game Changers, and Sunbury Motor Company. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Great to be with you on this Friday. Hope you had a wonderful 4th of July. And the opening half hour of the show, brought to you by NIL Game Changers, your destination for name, image, and likeness opportunities for businesses, athletes. You have a lot of great people there to help you. Start your journey today at NILGameChangers.org. Todd, welcome. Great to have you with us.
Good afternoon. How are you doing?
Are there actually people in the building?
There is a car or two out in the parking lot, but I did not see any humans yet.
That's okay. I've been to the staff meeting. I've kind of questioned whether they're humans now. I'm just kidding. easy, cheap jokes. I mean, seriously. Surprise, Cotrillo's not calling. Oh, that's right. The Yankees aren't winning. Just got swept by the Reds. Very impressive. Very impressive.
I didn't even realize till I was checking the paper last night that they had fallen out of first place already, now too.
Oh, the Orioles are younger, more talented, smarter. Yeah, come on. And, you know, made the right moves, didn't overpay. You know, the Yankees are the shiny object group. Hey, look at over here! Oh, great shiny object, fabulous, right? Oh, you mean the shiny object isn't so shiny? That's why I see some of these salaries sometimes. A couple of them really baffle me. First of all, we'll start with the NBA. I mean, the NBA, there's so many, like, these huge contracts. It's not my money, so I don't care. But to me, it's one thing to pay LeBron or Jason Tatum or Jaylen Brown or Joel Embiid, you know, Giannis. Okay. But I see some other ones, I say, I can go, you got to be kidding me, right? Now, the 86 Celtics, right? You'd have been at the end of the bench.
I'm not sure how closely until this free agency period that I was paying attention to the new collective bargaining agreement, but I did not realize they couldn't do much if they get to that second apron in the sense that they can't make a lot of trades, they lose their salary cap exemptions. So, like, Boston is at that second apron, so what Boston's team is now is probably what it's going to be for the next three years, which isn't a bad thing, but they really won't be able to augment much.
But they put together a team already. And this is not a sentimental thing. For example, they know what they have works. It's just going to get older now as it gets older. You know, and you have to have some luck. I mean, for the Celtics, for example, it's, you know, and then I'll transition back to baseball. And by the way, give the phone number out. This is the Ask Anything Day.
It's 570-743-9565.
Cool. And you call, I don't care. Ask whatever you want. Doesn't matter. I can't answer it only because I'll sit there and go, I don't think I have an answer for that. I'll say so. If not, no problem. Everybody knows in these segments when I've done them, I think I pretty much have answered everything. But it doesn't mean there's not going to be one that comes up and go, how about that? Doggone.
Okay.
But I see like numbers put out there. Now, sit back and go, really? No, it's not my money, so I really don't care. Like, now the Yankees are going to run into this with Juan Soto. Now, Juan Soto is a really good, terrific, talented player. But here comes the trivia question of the day. The six highest paid pitchers in Major League Baseball.
Steve how many? Show. This is Todd speaking.
I think we got a question coming up. We'll do that.
Okay, one second.
There we go. But Todd, the six highest paid pitchers in the major leagues, how many wins have they combined for this year?
I apologize. I wasn't listening. We have our first caller, Steve.
Yeah, but I'm asking, you can hear me now, right?
Yes.
Okay, the six highest paid pitchers in Major League Baseball, how many wins have they combined for this season?
So I think Scherzer's 1 and 2. Cole doesn't have, I would say, 8.
6. Ah. Right? See, that goes back to the money part. They're talented, but you're part of what you're paying for is durability. So who's the first one up here? Hello. I think Todd's trying to get him on here.
Can you hear me?
Hello.
Sorry, it's Ken from Lewisburg.
Oh, there you go. Hey, Ken, how are you today? Happy 4th to you. Hope you're enjoying it.
You too also. I'm taking you totally off topic, but I was curious.
Sure.
I have 4 children, all raised in Lewisburg. One is still there. 2 Division I athletes. 3rd one didn't want to be. And my last one is a daughter, and she's a 3 or 4 sport athlete, depending upon her mood, essentially. I was wondering, because she plays on an AAU basketball team, and she's come up against boys. Now, quite frankly, the ones that she came up against were simply there because they couldn't make the boys' team. But how do you feel about the transgender, boys competing against girls?
Yeah. Well, let's just say in her case, okay. Let's just take her case for example. So she's been competing against boys, right? So just so you know,
well,
in women's basketball,
they signed up for the girls' team. Yes.
Right, but she's competing against boys right now, right?
No, AAU, it's a girls' traveling team.
Oh, a girls'
but
traveling team.
The opposing teams have boys that supposedly identify as girls.
Oh, okay. Well, you know what? I won't get into that part of it. I won't get into that part of it, but I will get into this part of it as to how women's basketball works. And, for example, in colleges, left and right, everybody, I don't care if it's UConn, Iowa, Penn State, whomever, their practice teams are usually guys.
Oh, no, I agree with you. She has no problem with that whatsoever. I mean, she wasn't raised to
it makes them better without question. It does. And that's how they practice. So she's going to get better just by going through the competition like that, in terms of the physicality. And one of the great stories here was Nick Colella is a guy who's now in administration here at Penn State. And Nick went to Penn State Bayrand, and he played in the basketball team there. So he comes down here, and they said, hey, you should try out to be one of the women's basketball practice players. So he went to do it, and I guess somebody said, hey, you're really good. He said, why don't you try out for the men's team? And he did, and he made it. He ended up starting. He started a couple games along the way. Now he's one of Pat Kraft's right-hand people up there because he's turned into an administrator. So that's really one of the great stories. But, yeah, I don't mind competition now. But I'm also girls should be, you know, when it comes to the actual games, girls should be playing against girls, boys against boys.
Well, she's been playing against her three brothers her whole life and been to every wrestling tournament and everything else. So that really wasn't the point.
Yeah, no, I know what your point is. I just, you know, but I know what your point is.
And if you can just look up one of the better quarterbacks in Lewisburg history, and then you'll know who I am.
Okay. I can't wait to look it up and see. All right.
You have a good day.
You have a great day. Thanks so much for the call.
All right.
Boy, what an athletic family. How about that? Ooh. That is some athletic family there.
His preface, I thought I knew who it was, but the daughter threw me off, so now I have to think for a little bit.
Yeah, you would know. Boy, that's... Boy. But so the daughter is going to be a recruited athlete, and then the three sons already have been?
Yes.
Holy mackerel.
I believe I know who it is now. One's a wrestler.
Yep.
The other one, I was going to say, one was the quarterback, and one now, the daughter now plays softball and field hockey, and I think she's a basketball player in the winter, but I'm not positive.
Jeez. That's amazing. Wow. Huh.
And if it's the Ken I'm thinking about, he used to be the head football coach at Lords Regional back in the late 90s.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. So he knows his deal. He knows his deal. Okay.
I was going to say, he might know a Chesney or two as well.
All right. Well, that's one on Ask Anything Day. And again, you can jump in anytime you want. It's Ask Anything Day, whatever. And that is it's always a fun day because I always get a lot of completely different questions. Yeah, some of them are personal, some aren't. Like that one wasn't. That was just a philosophical question. But yeah, I guess he said that she's competed against boys in wrestling too, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's kind of been, you know, I think that's one of the reasons that they started girls wrestling in Pennsylvania, just because there was getting to be so many girls, and
right.
And the other part of it is some areas that take high school wrestling very seriously.
Yeah.
We're using the girls in defense of the Catholic schools to make a statement, because the Catholic schools weren't allowed to wrestle male versus female.
Right, yeah.
So they were kind of using it as a way to make a statement about recruited athlete, you know, the public private school debate and the PIAA and various other things. And I think rather than having that continue, that was one of the big reasons too.
Right. And then I look at I was out in Iowa 2 years ago. You know, we go out there every year for basketball, so it turned out that I was there. And they have a side arena in Coralville, which I think is where Iowa Gymnastics. I know it's off campus, but I think Iowa Gymnastics performs there, and they have a minor league hockey team there, whatever. They were having this huge youth wrestling. It was boys and girls. And the hotel was just absolutely packed. I mean, now the last time I saw it packed was we were there in 2016 for the Iowa caucuses. So that's the last time I saw that hotel. It's a Hyatt now. It used to be a Marriott. And I'm talking, it was wall to wall in the lobby all the way back to the conference rooms. All parents with their young wrestlers. And this tournament was huge. So very impressive. I mean, the tournament was unbelievable. Now, the Iowa caucuses, I remember CNN was set up in the lobby, and Jeb Bush was in the bar. It didn't go well that night. And Dick Girardi and I are sitting there. I've told this story before. You guys know this one. Dick Girardi and I were sitting. We just walked into the restaurant just to see if there were any seats. And we're looking around. There weren't many seats. And we looked in the corner. And Dick says, Jesus, that guy looks familiar. And I looked at him. He says, sure does. And then Dick says, that's Jeb Bush. I says, yeah. Sitting alone, I might add.
Steve, we got Doug from Wellsboro in the line.
Yeah, with a beverage, I might add. So then we walk back. You'll love this. So we're done. So we walk back, and the players were coming out after eating in the back. And the player said, you won't believe who we just saw. And Dick says, proudly says, yeah, we saw him too, Jeb Bush. They went, who? Jeb Bush. Oh, no. We saw the guys from Duck Dynasty. They're here in the hotel. Hi, Doug. How are you today?
Hey, Steve. How are you?
Doing well. Yeah, doing great.
How was your trip to Weymouthport?
It's fine. I went up yesterday, took care of it, came back, and I go back up there tonight. You know, so it's good. Okay. Those people are very nice to me up there.
The question is, did you ever fail anyone in your class?
Did I ever fail anybody in my class? I've given incompletes, but not Fs. I've given incompletes, and there have been circumstances surrounding incompletes, so yeah, I've done that. And be honest with you, Doug, when you do that in the system here, then I have to then explain. Like, I don't understand why I have to explain it's an incomplete. I think the student has to explain why it's incomplete. I've got to go through all this paperwork and rigmarole explaining why I gave an incomplete, because they have all these designations. And I'll sit there and I'll say, well, which one do I pick here? And then I think to yourself, oh, for goodness sakes. So after giving a couple of incompletes, I've tried to get a hold of the students that were then eventually going to qualify for incomplete, saying, look, you got to get this stuff done, because that way I can give you a grade and I don't have to go through the paperwork.
How many total years did you teach class?
I'm going up, coming into my 22nd season, so 22nd year of doing it, and this will be the last year I teach coming up. I'm not going to teach after spring of next year.
Did you just have enough of it, or why are you giving it up?
I'm probably because it's in my life. No, games do not run their course. I love games, but this has run its course for me. How about that?
Okay.
You know, it just kind of gets to a point. You're like, okay, you know. A lot of things are different since the pandemic. That's also another part of it, too. The class size is also, when I started, the class size was 10 each semester, which was guaranteed. So you could really work with people. Now it's in the mid-20s. And there's not quite the same level of individual or control over it.
I understand. Totally different subject. Do you know, Joe used to have the house on the shore. I think Joe and Sue, did they own that house? And does Sue still have it as of today, or the family still have it as of today?
It's in Avalon, yes. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. So
I know people used to see Joe walk along the beach or something in the morning sometimes. Mm-hmm. You used to talk to him.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, in Avalon, New Jersey. So that's where, yep. And they go there every year. I think they might be there now, I think.
So. Okay. Last question. What do you think of Andy Kolteniecki? Am I going to see something innovative this fall? Am I going to see using the strength of the players? What's your first impressions?
Well, it's the latter that you mentioned. The key for any coordinator, play caller, or any coach for that matter, how do I get the most out of the players I have? Always. And I need to get the ball into the hands of my playmakers. you need to have multiple playmakers to really make it effective. And that's what he wants to do. Right? You can be as innovative as you want, right? But did you get the ball into the playmakers? Let me give you a good example. You've heard me tell this story before. You mentioned Joe. Okay. So Penn State had run a play in practice all week that was a late game situation where they got the ball to Mike Archie. Okay. And they're playing Michigan State up there. And so they call a timeout. Wally Richardson was the quarterback. And in the timeout, they call the play they worked on during the week. Well, Joe came over, and Joe said, what are we running here? And they said, we're going to do this, this, this. It's going to go to Archie. And he says, no. I said, what do you mean, no? He said, I want to get the ball to Bobby Engram. They said, no, Joe, look, we worked on this all week. We're all set. He said, no, the ball's going to Bobby Engram. They said, why is the ball going to Bobby Engram? He says, he's the best player in the field. He says, I want to win this with my best player. Well, they ran a middle screen to Bobby Engram, and guess what he did? He scored.
Yeah, I remember the play yesterday. I remember it.
It's not as if Mike Archie couldn't have scored, but I'm saying, but he got it to Engram. That's what good coaches do. They get the ball into the hands of their best players. That's what I'm watching Andy. That's what Andy does. Andy doesn't just call plays to call plays. Andy calls plays with a purpose, and a primary purpose is to get the ball into the hands of the best playmakers.
Okay. Thanks, Steve. You're doing a good job, Todd.
Thank you.
Todd is doing a good job.
Yeah. Talk to you later.
Thanks, Doug. Just went through Wellsboro last week, as a matter of fact. Thursday I went through Wellsboro. You know, kind of gave a little quick tip of the cap to Doug as I went through Wellsboro last week.
You just should have screamed his name out the window to see if somebody answered.
I should have just... I had something I really had to do, but I should have... One of these days I'm going to have to go through there and just like sit down and have dinner with Doug.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. While Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
You want a unique way to display your brand. You need a team of seasoned experts to work with. You want to reach customers who buy. You want NIL Game Changers, a versatile consulting agency powered by former student athletes and coaches who work as NIL sports agents. NIL Game Changers will help you build powerful relationships with customers through compelling stories, with student athlete influencers as your leading edge. Finally, we'll equip you with the right media to drive your success home. NILGameChangers.org, building meaningful relationships with your customers.
Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, this half hour brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, RV. Yeah, we can rattle off all the insurance needs, but there are multiple insurance needs for all of us. They handle them all. And customer service means everything to them. At Purdy Insurance. And it's July 5th. And Todd, we're just, what, a mere 33 days away from the Purdy Memorial Golf Tournament to benefit the Greater Susquehanna Valley YMCA. We're looking forward to being out there. I guess Todd went out and shot a 300 par 68 the other day, so he's feeling great about his game.
And then my wife nudged me awake.
Wasn't going to reveal that part.
The only time I've ever shot that low was on a video game, so.
Oh, you in the suit. All right. Okay.
Honestly, that's what I thought you were talking about at first. I was like, no, the NCAA football game comes out in like 2 weeks, man.
Yeah. So, all right. So it's Ask Anything Day, which is fun. I always enjoy it. I always get really interesting questions. I've already had a couple of really interesting questions today. But yeah, whatever you want, just give me a call. We'll talk about it. And, go from there. Things maybe you're curious about or want to get more perspective on or whatever. It's okay. So, yeah.
The number here at the station, again, is 570-743-9565 if you want to call.
All right. So jump in. Love to hear you. I love talking to people. You know, I do a lot of speaking engagements. I just did one in Johnstown 2 weeks ago was the last one I did. But I mean, I've already gone to Jacksonville, Daytona Beach, Philly, Newcastle, Johnstown, Columbus. Yeah. Oh, I'll cross state lines. and I love talking to people. I love listening to, and like every comment is not that I get is not positive in, the kumbaya part of it. I'll get questions. I mean, I was down in Jacksonville. And, they were asking me about James and in big games and so forth. That's fine. Again, I am never a person that is opposed to somebody's opinion as long as they have facts to back up their opinion. Oh, and by the way, we can take the same set of facts and have different opinions. Right. If it's an opinion that is baseless of fact, then you very politely and talk to them about like, okay, well, let me give you some background and perspective, right? But if
in this stretch of big games. Have they truly lost to somebody that was less talented than them? I don't think they have. I mean, they haven't played well at times, but I don't think any of these would be considered an upset.
Right. I also understand, though, the expectations of the fan base.
Yes. I get that part of it as well.
Right. So the expectation of the fan base is they feel that Penn State can go toe-to-toe with anybody. That's the way the recruiting has been coming out. And people will ask me, what's missing? And I said, I usually think 9 times out of 10, not always, but 9 times out of 10, it's like a play each half. How do you find a play each half? I mean, that's what you have to find. I mean, look how tight the Michigan game was last year. Tight game. Okay, they ended up winning the national championship. Right? Penn State did not convert when they needed to convert. Michigan got a 30-yard run from Blake Corum. When they're playing Ohio State 2 years ago here, they take the lead. There's 8 minutes to go. They're in front. Great. And all of a sudden, they get a big pass play to Harrison. Henderson takes off on a long run. Like, great, you're behind. After you fought all day to put yourself in front. So their ability to go toe-to-toe with teams has been there. Now, the bowl game, look, too many guys opted out of the bowl game, you know, to feel like, I mean, that really in a lot of ways is not the same team you played with during the course of the year. That's why in the Rose Bowl was terrific because Utah had, what, two opt-outs? And Penn State had two opt-outs. That was it. Essentially, it's the same team against the same team that would have played in October as opposed to playing on January, what, 2nd, I think they played on. Okay? And, you know, and that's where I think comes into play, where I talk about the possibility of written contracts with players. That was the be-all, end-all, but you can put in there, okay, look, we're, you know, you have to maintain this grade point average under NCAA rules and so forth, blah, 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 blah. Okay, of the $22 million, you wouldn't put that part in, but you know, I'm just throwing that in so everybody knows. Of the $22 million, you're going to get this. In return, you have to be available for every game that Penn State is playing. Not scheduled to play, is playing. Because you can then say, well, the bowl game's not on the schedule. So you'd have to say every game Penn State is playing. You know, that is that kind of caveat, to put that in there, you have to do something for the fan base. Right? Because the fans are upset. The fans are getting upset about people not playing in bowl games. And I think that, you know, and that bothers them. Now, how much are they going to be bothered by the money part of it that is mandated? But that's what I've tried to tell people when they've been upset. I said, well, Penn State didn't choose to do this. It's mandated. It's a court mandate. Now, it's a settlement, but if they'd gone to court, they'd have lost. And if they'd lost, it would have been triple the number, and a lot of people would have gone out of business in intercollegiate athletics. There's no way in heck you know, I mean, that's the problem.
It's already seems to be coming for the Division III schools. I don't know if I think it's probably more the pandemic right now than it is athletics, but you can't look anywhere without one of a Division III school closing. I think Clark Summit University up above Scranton's closing at the end of the month, I believe.
Yeah, there's been a couple I've seen that are closing, and it's a big issue moving forward, and I'm concerned. Athletics is more than just football and basketball. And there's going to be an impact on intercollegiate athletics somewhere in the country where, because of the money that, you know, the roughly $22 million in the first year, I have to start asking questions like, are there going to be some sports, just to ask, doesn't mean it will happen. Because I asked the same question during the pandemic, and it turned out nothing was dropped. But are going to be some sports that are moved to club sports?
We have another caller, Steve.
Okay. Hey, how are you today? I hope you're having a great fourth. Who do we have?
This is Randy from Winter Garden, Florida.
Randy? Okay. Now, if you made that call to me, Thanksgiving or Christmas, the envy would be coming out in my voice.
The real feel is only 110 today.
Oh, well, hold on a second, my friend. Randy, my real feel is actually 93. So what do you have on your mind, my
friend? Went to a couple of Spikes games when it was Real Field 100 or whatever, and it was hot in the field.
Yeah, it was. It was. I mean, you don't mind me asking you. We got a couple minutes here. All right. So in Winter Garden, when it's 110, what do you do and what don't you do?
I behave like I did when it was February in Pennsylvania. I stay indoors and don't go out.
There you go, Randy. What do you have on your mind today?
I have a question for you. What do you feel that the students, whether they're on campus today or like 10 years from now, what memory would you like them to have, or what knowledge would you like them to have about the legacy of Joe Paterno?
That he was a great coach who was also a man who cared about people and cared about the campus. He won football games, but he did it the right way. He didn't cut corners to do it. But he also made sure that he wanted to leave the campus. He wanted to leave everything that he was doing as he kept going, whether it was the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, he wanted to make the place better. When you get up there and you make a speech to the Board of Trustees like he did in 1983 after winning the national championship, and he said, look, we're number one in football. I want Penn State to be number one in everything it does. That's what I want them to remember. And the fact he's a great, great family man. And, you know, and Sue, of course, is still here. And, you know, his children and grandchildren. But he said, I want Penn State to be number one in everything it does. And that's because he cared. You know, and he raised a lot of money toward that. He helped raise a lot of money toward making that happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was concerned with NIL and everything, that whole thing about academics and athletics is going to be disconnected in the future.
Yeah, you know, Randy, that's something I'm going to find very interesting. Glad you brought that up. That's a really good point on your part. You know, what is the connection between academics and the money part of it? And the bottom line is, you're still going to have to go to school. You're still going to have to maintain a grade point average. And not only that, the program's going to have to maintain an APR average, which the APR average, no offense, I really don't care about the analytic of APR. I care about graduation rates. If people are getting their degree, somebody asked me about APR the other day, and I said, Penn State football's graduation rates in the 80 to 90% range. I said, they're getting their degrees. I said, you know, all this stuff is based on, you know, transfers. What do they do after they transfer? It's like, there's so much movement. It's hard to keep track of what an APR is. Did they get their degree? That's important. Because you and I both know, Randy, that 2 to 3% have a chance to make it at the next level. The other 97 to 98% are absolutely going to need that degree.
Yeah, that's the impression that I got. I'm class of 78, and my four children went there also, and it's just the impact that he's had on our lives. I just feel so blessed by that, and just feel that's going to be missing from students that attend there in the future, and just wish that some of his history could rub off on the future students as well.
You hope, but you know what? I find, Randy, just, you know, just to be straight about it, the students I'm teaching in class for this upcoming year will be 21 or 22 years old, right? That means when everything happened here, they were 9 or 10 at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And as time goes, it's going to get further and further. I'll tell you what does bother me is when I go on the road and I see, for example, how saluted Bo Schembechler is on the campus, how saluted Woody Hayes is on campus, how saluted Bear Bryant, I mean, I've been to all these places, is on campus. You know, and Penn State had somebody really special. So it's just a personal, you know, I don't make policy and I don't make recommendations on policy. But when I go and see other places, I think to myself, hey, guess what? Quote, our guy was just as special as your guy.
Yeah, I think that speaks of our guy also, that I don't think that he sought some of that recognition the way some others might have.
Oh, no, I mean, the statue? No. Oh. He's like, Steve, I don't even... No. I know a lot of... the statue is symbolic, so that I do understand, and it means more to other people. It means more to other people than it meant to him.
Well, that's all I have. I appreciate talking to you. Listening to you over the years, and I'm just looking forward to many years in the future of listening to you.
Hey, anytime you're up at Medler Field, stop by, say hi, or at a football game. Always look forward to talking to you, Randy. And enjoy Winter Garden and its 110 and the 110 degree heat index.
Yes, sure.
I've got to. Thank you. All right. Take care, Randy. All right. We'll take a break. We'll come back more in a moment. See, these Ask Anything Fridays, I have more fun with this. Like, I love doing interviews and talking with Todd and so forth, but I have more fun with this, I think, than anything. I love talking. Like I said, I love talking to people. I love hearing what they have to say, what they think, and what's on their mind. All right. We'll come back more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. This half hour brought to you by Purdy Insurance.
Hi, this is Season. For over 100 years, the Purdy Insurance Agency has been protecting families and businesses of the greater Susquehanna Valley and beyond. With the experience of our trained and knowledgeable staff, you can rest assured that your needs will be evaluated and met by some of the industry's best representatives. No matter what your insurance needs are, call Purdy Insurance today at 570-286-5855. Visit our website at purdyinsurance.com or check us out on Facebook to see what we can do for you.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
All right, great to have you with us on the show today. I do have to go back up to Williamsport tonight. Was there yesterday for a game. Cutters are playing well. Good team. The MLB draft is 9 days away. Yeah, it goes over a couple-day period, so it's, you know, but round one's 9 days away.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it's the 12th, right?
Yeah, that's a Saturday. Let's see. No, that's a Friday. I think the draft is the 14th, isn't it?
That sounds a little better.
Sunday night.
The internet's horrible here.
Let me just see. MLB draft. I think the first night is Sunday, I think. Dates. Oh, they want to verify if I'm human. Really? Verification successful. I feel really good. July 14th. So it takes place the 14th, Monday the 15th, and then the final round is the 16th before the All-Star game is played down in the Metroplex. I think the draft's going to take place in Fort Worth.